With the permission of the chair, sir, can we start the program?
AMSCA. AMSCA, no.
So you have to unmute yourself. You have to unmute yourself, sir.
I think everybody got energized with the gracious presence of the director of ZSI. Please go ahead, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Pratibha, madam, can you play the ICR song, please?
जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की, सुखद प्रतीक हरित भारत की। कृषि धन पशुधन मानव जीवन, दुग्ध मत्स्य फल यंत्र सुवर्धन। वैज्ञानिक विधि नव तकनीके, पारिस्थितिकी का संरक्षण। शस्य श्यामला छवि भारत की, जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की। हिम प्रदेश से सागर तट तक, मरुधरती से पूर्वोत्तर तक। हर पथ पर है मित्र कृषक की, शिक्षा शोध प्रसार सकल तक। आशा स्वावलंबित भारत की, जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की। जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की।
I'm sorry for the technical glitch because of dual streaming between YouTube and this has got a mess. I'm sorry for that. May I enter into the program, sir?
Please, sir, go ahead.
Thank you. At the outset, I would like to thank ICR for providing this wonderful platform to come together and exchange our ideas and learn new concepts. On this line, let me take this opportunity to thank Dr. T.R. Sharma, our DDG Crop Sciences ICAR, and our ADG, Dr. A.C. Dubey, sir, for being the guiding force and always supporting us and supporting us to have such programs being conducted so that we could exchange ideas across the sectors rather than only being fit into only the internal affairs. On this occasion, I would like to invite or welcome Dr. Nagesh, Director of NBIR. The moment the idea was mooted to have this topic, and Director of ZSI, Dr. Dhruti Madam, he saw to that the program could take place in time. I thank him for the opportunity given and I welcome him for the program. Now, the chief guest of the day, I would say it's a celebrity on academic circles because I didn't have an opportunity to
Jaya Jaya Krishi Parishad Bharat Ki, Sukhad Pratik Harit Bharat Ki, Krishi Dhan Pashu Dhan Manav Jeevan, Dugdh Matsya Phal Yantra Suvardhan, Vaigyanik Vidhi Nav Taknike, Paristhitiki Ka Sanrakshan, Shasya Shyamala Chavi Bharat Ki, Jai Jai Krishi Parishad Bharat Ki.
Wait is over and they have identified a
Him Pradesh se Sagar Tat Tak, Marudharti se Purvottar Tak. Har Path Par Hai Mitr Krishak Ki, Shiksha Shodh Prasar Sakal Tak. आशा स्वावलंबित भारत की, जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की, जय जय कृषि परिषद भारत की।
And then asking her to take a new position just because of the career as a taxonomist, I think she has gelled very well with the taxonomy, and she has taken up the taxonomy to the highest level, bringing in the molecular and things like that. And sometimes speaking taxonomy itself alone may be boring to not all but to few, but she has integrated in such a beautiful way the functional diversity too. And also, what interested me the max was she has tried to integrate the taxonomy with the societal service, that is the forensic entomology, where the medical legal cases are unsolved, and this could really complement. With so much decorations to her academic career and to her professional expertise, I don't find any reason why she should not occupy the chair and bring a beauty to it. At this, I take this opportunity on behalf of ICR-NBIR to welcome Dhriti Madam to address us, and it's very fortunate to hear you, Madam, today. Welcome, Madam. And we also have a lot of luminaries of crop protections who have been serving this institute and other organizations of ICAR who are amongst us, and they are here to hear the webinar, hear the talk, and also give their suggestions or opinions or come for our discussions. At this juncture, may I invite Dr. Abraham Varghese, sir, former director, ICR-NBIR, Dr. Chandish Madam, former director, ICR-NBIR, Dr. Bhaktavachalam, former director, ICR-NBIR, Dr. Manika Vasaram, former head of entomology from Annamalai University. And we have also are having a battery of scientists from both ZSI and the other research organization. May I take this opportunity to welcome all the senior colleagues from ICR system and the non-ICR system too. And also, we have an active participation of all the senior colleagues, research scholars, and students from both NAS and the non-NAS system. That shows the interest in the topic. So they have all gathered here to hear and cherish the joy of taxonomy. May I take this opportunity on behalf of ICR-NBIR to welcome all of you for this wonderful webinar that we are going to experience today. Thank you. May I invite Dr. Nagesh for his introductory remarks, please.
Right. Good evening, all. And this is a very special day for all of us to invite Dr. Dhriti Banerjee, Madam, for the event today, Director ZSI, for this important conversation between her and us on an important topic that we always cherish to hear from experts, because taxonomy and the implications and the kind of newness in the subject and the requirement, global requirements, is something that is still a kind of unknown arena for most agriculture scientists across the country and students that who are coming up. And the importance of musea collections, then the kind of under the current era of access, benefit sharing, and biosecurity, cataloging of these biodiversity and digital inventorization of genetic resources, both plants, animals, fish, and insects have become very essential requirements. And as I would like to just say to the chief guest today that ICR-NBIR, though one of the bureaus of Indian Agriculture, Council of Agriculture Research, has started bureau activities on a little infantile recent times. That is since 2014, we have become the bureau, and our emphasis on insects in a very systematic manner has started very recently. Although in the country, many of agriculture universities, then ZSI by itself or FRI or many other institutions have started on insects. But basically, this is an opportunity that was given to this institute to become a bureau. And we have started with three departments, that is collection and characterization, germplasm conservation and utilization, and genomic resources of insects and insect-derived resources. However, having said that, I would always acknowledge the, I take this opportunity rather, to acknowledge the services and the advancement and their contributions done by ZSI, which is one of the oldest organizations of this country, which has done a lot of proud to India, probably from pre-British time onwards. So I think this is a great opportunity, and none other than Dr. Dhriti Madam, who has a lot of things on her crown, especially the digitization of which very relevant to us, inventorization and genetic sequencings and all kinds of issues that we are now trying to address. They have gone little far ahead of us, and today such a luminary and accomplished lady is going to give us lot of information, and I don't want to take more time on this, but certainly, madam, you are now to take over, and thank you very much. I thank you, and I to the audience, I would like to say, Dr. Dhriti madam has been such a simple lady. Whenever we contacted, she has given her straight away information, very simple manner, and she said, in spite of her all her difficulties, her engagements, she still said, we will make it on 6th of October, and she would be with us for this event. Thank you very much, ma'am, for all this, and I also thank all my colleagues who have made it possible. Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Swaran.
Please unmute, sir.
Yes, sir. Sorry. Now we will have the talk by our distinguished speaker, Dr. Dhriti Madam. Madam, could you share your screen? In the meantime, I could.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Just a minute, madam. Just a minute.
Sure.
Introduction of a speaker need not be tons and lines of words. Just as a quote says, Rome was not built in a day. She has built her academic career over a long period of time, and the award that she has got as an exceptional Women of Excellence by Women's Economic Forum from The Hague, Netherlands, clearly speaks about it. And what better person can we have to address us today on this area? Please, madam.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Nagesh, for inviting me today. And namaskar to all of you who are present here. Actually, on my screen, I can see only 5 faces. So I have to say good afternoon to only those people I can see, because I have Dr. Chandish on my screen, Dr. Varghese, I have Dr. Shubharan, and I have Ankita, and the rest of them are not on my screen. So it's a very, very good afternoon to all of you. And a thank you for inviting me for speaking to you. It's not about, I don't want to give a talk. I want to just speak to you regarding what ZSI and NBI can think about the tomorrow of our country. So at the very beginning, I'd like to say that I'm deeply humbled by your kind words, Dr. Nagesh and Dr. Shubharan. And I don't know whether I merit, I mean, such an amount of appreciation which you have done, but I'm deeply humbled. And I hope that I'm going to work very hard to take ZSI to those heights which I can dream, and which I can dream and I of, and I hope I'm going to make that dream a reality in times to come. And it will be with support from people like you, who will be also a part of our system and our basically our way forward as we go ahead. And so with this, as I would like to say, the fact that as you have, I mean, if I don't say a few words on that, that ZSI is a 105-year-old organization, and its first women scientist was Mrs. Meera Mansukhani in 1949. So at that point of time, for a lady to go out on a survey trip with a set of male members, and that for her, what would I say, for a family to permit her to go, and she having the courage to grow, that was actually breaking the glass ceiling. What I did was I just merely pulled that process forward, and today I'm sitting in the chair of director. it was possibly because that courage and fearlessness which she had displayed at once upon a time way back in 1950s, you know, that was a very commendable thing to do at that point of time. So, and yes, it is a sad thing that ZSI, Zoological Survey of India, did never appoint a women chief. But in course of time, the Ministry of Environment and Forest has found it, thought it was the high time that there should be some women sitting on the seat. And lo and behold, I'm here. And thank you for everything. And thank you for all your kind words once again. So, let this be a kind of a little bit of an interactive session, how far as possible, because it's not exactly what I'm trying to preach or teach. It is just like we are sharing a little bit of information about Zoological Survey of India for those of whom you're not exactly aware what we are about. Because most of the people think that ZSI, the job of ZSI is making listing. Aap to list banate hain. So it's exactly not listing, and there's a lot more to it than the kind of work which we do. So I just want to just take you through that journey. So I want to present. Let me share my screen. Am I on a slideshow mode?
Yes, madam, you are.
Okay. So we are on the 75th year of independence, as you know, and all of us are celebrating Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav. And I guess it is one of my privilege to be the part of a setup and to sit on this chair on the 75th year of independence. This not only is a kind of significant thing for the women in science, but is also a kind of, say, point of significance for the country to have somebody sitting on a chair on this seat at after a span of 105 years. So I guess it is, I am extremely grateful to God for where I'm today, and also to all my people who have supported me in this long journey. So with this, I'll start that Zoological Survey of India is a part of the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, which I guess all of you know by now. And my topic would be taxonomic diversity versus functional diversity in insects. So back to basics, but looking forward. Yes, why is taxonomy important? Which is a thing which we have been trying to tell everybody over a period of time. We have been trying to explain it to the ministry. We are trying to explain it to everybody around us, the relevance of the subject and why taxonomy is important. Rather, I'd say we always try to say why we are important rather than about taxonomy being important. So if I go through the brief history of ZSI, which I guess all of you know by now, it was instituted in 1916. And the primary mandate or the primary objective of ZSI was to promote survey, exploration, research on the faunal diversity of the country. And this has been going on for a very long time. It has started from the British era, and it has been continuing ever since. A lot of our collections are housed in the Natural History Museum, as well as in the Indian Museum, as well as in our regional centers. And that is why we are one of the largest repositories in India, and we are designated as a national repository. So the primary vision of ZSI is taxonomy towards conservation, sustaining biodiversity and faunal diversity for future. In other words, as you know about the CBD and the access and benefit sharing, as well as sustainable development of goals, it's mostly about taxonomy towards conservation and sustainable utilization of biodiversity. So our mission is to contribute towards monitoring conservation of fauna by, and our basic job is to conduct status survey, primary job, I would say. Status survey, conducting surveys of wildlife, protected species, and taxonomic studies on the faunal diversity of our country. So we have our headquarters housed in Calcutta, and we have 16 regional centers, which is all over India, spread all over India. The regional centers and ZSI was primarily instituted with a thought or what an idea, I would say, would be to cater to the different ecosystems and to study the fauna of those particular biogeographic regions of India particular ecosystems which they were targeted for. For example, if it's the desert regional center of Jodhpur, each of the centers were also had an area of jurisdiction, had particular jurisdiction, which would be with related areas only. So like Jodhpur would be catering to Rajasthan as well as parts of the Gulf of Kutch, as which will be working on the desert, arid and the semi-arid region. Dehradun and Solon will be working on the high altitude, will be catering to that information found in the high altitude areas of India. Similarly, we have the Northeast, we have Arunachal Pradesh, we have Shillong, and then in we have Gangetic Plains Regional Center catering to the Gangetic Plains. Then down south, we have the Fresh Marine Biological Center, Biology Research Center in Chennai, as well as we are catering to Western Ghats. So we have a WGRC in Kerala. And I think I know, you know by now, all of them, which is there. We also have a center in Canning, which is working on the Sundarbans. We have a center in Marine Aquarium in Digha, which is working on the marine fauna, as well as in estuarine fauna. We have one in Gopalpur. So this is basically the brief about the structural organization of ZSI. So we have several primary mandates and we have several secondary mandates. The primary mandates is the one based on which we had our basic work activities were structured upon, which was basically exploration, survey, inventory, and monitoring of biodiversity of states, ecosystems, and protected areas of India. So this was also obviously whenever it is inventory and documentation of faunal diversity, it would be identification of species, and that was what identification and characterization, and that was what taxonomic studies at one point of time was all about. We were supposed to do a periodic review of the status of threatened endemic species. We'll be preparing the red data book, the fauna of India, the fauna of states. We would be doing the bioecological studies. We'll be preparing databases for the species recorded. Maintenance and development of the National Zoological Collection was one of the biggest mandate which we are catering to. Training and capacity building, faunal identification and advisory services, and publication of fauna of India and fauna of states. There are several secondary mandates for which we have the EIA or Environmental Impact Assessment Studies, maintenance and development of museums of headquarters and regional centers. Then we have the ENVIS and the CITES centers, which we are catering to. We have research fellowships, associateships, and emeritus scientist programs. We have several collaborative research programs. This is where NBIR comes along with ZSI, and where is the handholding needed. And then we have GIS and remote sensing studies for animal diversity, as well as for threatened species, as well as DNA barcoding and cytotaxonomy. The primary reason why I'm elaborating on this is the simple reason is that most of the time people think we make a list, but the list also includes so many different aspects for which very few people exactly have any information upon. So the approach, how do we approach our studies? How do we approach? It is basically measuring both genetic database as well as the morphometric digital and genetic database of the faunal diversity. We are modeling on a geospatial mode and we are monitoring long-term to track the effect of climate change. So that was ZSI was about the past, and this is ZSI at present and the future of ZSI. So as of now, you know that this is the status of diversity of India, and I guess I don't have to go into all that, but as you know, India is a mega diverse country, and this is the status of diversity, as well as the different protected areas, national park, wildlife sanctuaries, so on and so forth in India. So here, this is one slide which we love to share with everybody, just to show, basically, it's like flaunting ourselves at the kind of work we have done over a period of time. So out of the states and union territories, out of 36 states and union territories, we have actually documented 26 of them. Out of the 10 biogeographic zones, we have completed the documentation of the faunal diversity of 8 of the biogeographic zones. Of the national park and wildlife sanctuaries, this is where we are lagging a bit behind. We have done only 64 out of the 660 because our target specifications were not about the national parks and wildlife sanctuaries when we had started working. Actually, it was more on the states and the union territories of biosphere reserves and tiger reserves. We have documented 18 of the 70 biospheres and tiger reserves. And for the eco-sensitive zones, we have documented more than 500. We have proper documentation of the marine ecosystem, grassland ecosystem, estuarine, freshwater, desert, and mountain ecosystems. So these are the areas for which we have documentation of the entire faunal diversity of these areas. In case any of you need any document on this regard, please feel free to tap us for this. So as you know, that one of our major discoveries or in major publications is basically animal discoveries. And we do a compilation every year about, we in Zoological Survey of India prepare the database for the species of the fauna, of the Indian fauna. And in the BSI, the Botanical Survey of India, they do about the Indian plants. So as of now, we have in India have 1,02,718 species, which is a very substantive amount. And this table would be narrating about each of the distribution, which I won't go into but this is one of our substantive work, which we publish every year. And this is usually now released by the minister, but previously, once upon a time, it was to be released by the president. Then it was at the Rashtrapati Bhavan, but because of security reasons, we are now releasing the book through the hands of the environment minister. So maybe in some point of time, we could go ahead and get it released by the Prime Minister of India at some point of time. So what is the primary, the legacy of the 100 years of ZSI? The legacy is the National Zoological Collection. So we have a huge collection, and you in NBI, you also have a collection which is maintained by you. And I guess you maintain it very well because you have a lot of people working, people from there also come down so often to our places. So we have voucher specimens as well as type specimens, as well as different from all over India, as well as from several foreign countries, which have either contributed to our collection or they have been left behind by the Britishers during their surveys for the Indian adjacent countries specifically, as well as from different contributors from different universities, colleges, zoos, NGOs. They have all contributed to a collection, and we have a huge collection, which is almost 5.2 million specimens, which we have now in our collection. And that, I guess, is no small amount. It would raise eyebrows anywhere in the country, or rather I'd say anywhere in the world. So we have around 17,000 type specimens, 17 to 20,000 type specimens specifically. And we have gone into the process of digitizing. We have started digitizing and having the type specimens available on a portal so that people around the country can access the type specimens if needed. There may be so many. This is specifically important in recent times where, when we have COVID, previously people used to come down to ZSI for having a look at the specimens. You are free to come down to ZSI provided the travel restrictions are lifted and the scare of COVID is no longer there. But since this has become a very important source of information for researchers ever since 2019 onwards, because to say 2020 onwards, because of the importance of it, and whoever have wanted to study have accessed our collections digitally and have found and have actually reported, got back to us on a very positive note. So other than digitizing the collection, one of our important aspects, or back to basics and the way forward. So the way forward is basically, we have started having a DNA barcoding center at 20, which was established in 2012, along with a DNA barcoding center for DNA taxonomy in Dehradun, Hyderabad, Pune, Chennai, and Orissa. We are trying to have DNA laboratories in Andaman, in Digha, as well as in Solan, and which is also in process. So now DNA barcoding, as you know, it's not only in ZSI, but it's all over the world and all over India. It's become a huge priority area of DNA barcoding. So we are barcoding type specimens, especially the species which are being described new to science. They are usually DNA barcoded. And we are also barcoding the species under the scheduled animals. We are barcoding species under the CITES list. We have a plan of barcoding the basically barcoded some of the endemic species, and we have barcoded species of medical, forensic, and veterinary importance, as well as we have barcoded pollinators and pests, as well as lesser known animals and new species. So these are the basic areas for which the DNA barcoding lab caters to, and we have a plan of developing a DNA database of all the species which are in our collection and which we are collecting over a period of years. And I guess at one point of time would be in a position to share information, or also for other institutes like you to share your information with us, so that there is a complete comprehensive database about the DNA of the entire fauna of India. And that would cover everything, basically. It would be covering pest, parasite, species, endemic, endangered, CITES, threatened, medical, forensic, veterinary. It'll be one comprehensive list which would be available to everybody at some point of time. And I guess in this, it will be a kind of in a collaborative effort for a lot of organizations, not only for ZSI, but also for organizations like yours, as well as other universities and research organizations who are there, who are listening to it. You may also be able to share your information with us, and we will be developing a portal where we will be housing all the DNA barcodes of ZSI, and maybe also go ahead and basically cull in information or give links to your information, which may be in your portal of your institute. So as of now, we have generated something around 7,000, 8,000 barcodes, which I guess in the initial phase of our work was a little bit slow because we were setting up the laboratory and there were so many hitches, but now the work is very fast and we are rapidly progressing. One of the major, mainstay of ZSI is its publication, especially books. So we have in the last 6 months, we have something around 7 books published. We publish ZSI e-news every month. Then there are publications are in SCI journals, in peer-reviewed journals and book chapters. But as you know, that our mainstay are the books which we publish on the different faunal diversity of the states, union territories, protected areas, ecosystems, biogeographic zones. I mean, barring the scientific publications in different peer-reviewed journals or in the records of Zoological Survey of India. Okay, so one of the major impact job of ZSI is to periodic state review of the status of threatened and critically endangered and endemic species as well as threatened species. So this is one of those areas which we touch upon. So this is also the Red Data Book is basically prepared by us. We are a part of the framing of the Wildlife Protection Act, which is in the process of being reviewed. And we have contributed to it. We've not contributed to it. We are one of the main stakeholders in the Wildlife Protection Act because we are in the committee, which is framing the new rules, along with BSI and the WI and the Forest Department. And this is also a part of the same thing. And this is some of the wildlife scheduled animals, which we have been discussing, which I will want to. In ZSI is also a part of the CITES, and we have regular interactions, as well as for assessing the CITES list, as well as which species to be included. And one main adjunct of the CITES is the wildlife forensic laboratory, which we have in ZSI. Because we cater a lot to the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau as well as the Customs Department for identification of the different seized material, which is you basically caught at the borders, and we help in the wildlife law enforcement agencies for bringing these criminals to task. Okay, so some of the important work of ZSI, if I won't highlight, would be very unfortunate. One is the new discoveries and the new records. This, as I say, is one of our mainstay researches, which is the species discoveries every year and the new records to India. So the last year, these were the new species which have been described. There were several coleopterans, butterflies, fishes, and then Hemipteras dragonflies, where a few of them have been described last year, along with amphibians, then reptiles, so more or less crustaceans. So more or less, you can see we covered almost all the groups during our work. And I would say the trump card of ZSI is that we cater to protozoa, to the entire diversity, starting from protozoa to mammalia, and possibly we are the only organization who have such a broad spectrum, array of scientists who can work on so many different groups and produce tangible results, which can be basically can be seen by people around us. And as I say that for biologists, we would be one of the primary people who discovered, for even your scientists at NBI, as well as in ZSI, BSI. I mean, how many new medicines are we discovering every year? Very few in India, because there is so much of funding which goes into basic research, say, for example, for pharmacology, for pharmacogenetics, for molecular biology. But how many path-breaking discoveries are made? I'm not very certain about it. I may be basically a kind of over-enthusiastic about ZSI, but I guess that we in ZSI, BSI, as well as in allied organizations, we do a lot more discoveries than others do every year. So for whatever mode, it is something which is new discovery and it's a new to science. So I'm very proud of it. So the other one of our mainstay researchers is also the faunal documentation, assessing the faunal diversity of the states and the union territories. We have almost covered 23 states, as well as we have covered 8 of the 10 biogeographic zones. And we have done assess the faunal diversity of the biogeographic zones. And I guess only 2 of them are left. Once it is done, we will be covering almost the entire Indian fauna at one go. Other than biogeographic zones, one of our very important aspects of research is the faunal diversity of the ecosystems of India. We have completed the marine and coastal, the freshwater ecosystem, the Himalayan ecosystem, estuarine ecosystem, mangrove ecosystem, island ecosystem, the soil fauna and the seagrass. We have the some of the recent ones, 2 or 3 are in the pipeline, which I guess will be released this year. And I guess by next year we'll be completing almost all the major documentation of all the ecosystems. So if you add on all of this together, then basically if you say the faunal diversity of this, the documentation of the states and union territories, the biogeographic zone and the ecosystems, that would be the complete spectrum of Indian fauna, which is known from India. And I guess we would be the pioneers in doing it, even though it's basically our job, but again, we would be the first one to do it. So these are some of the books which has been published in the very recent years, last 2 years. So as you can see, we are covering almost all the aspects of research related to biodiversity. And these are the different books which we have. We have a catalog, we have taxonomic work, we have documentation work. And we also have a ZSI e-news, which is published every month, which is one of our major issues that we have been able to do it right from the onset. We have not missed one issue. We have not missed any month. Okay, so the next thing about ZSI, as I say, the way forward, is the digital ZSI. So way back in 2011 or 2012, we had first thought of, there was a lot of flooding in our library. So we have, the library is basically, and ZSI, it's housed in the first floor, a ground floor and the first floor. So firstly, first floor, there was flooding because it was a lot of rains, and the rainwater pipe somehow had kind of broken down or something, and the water had gushed inside the library. And it was that point of time in 2012, we had realized that it would be very important for us to digitize the publication, because these are such old books and they're in such fragile conditions that if they were not digitized, they wouldn't be available in the years to come. Or, I mean, some kind of calamity or catastrophe may happen and that may be destroying the books. And that was the primary reason when we started thinking about it. And in course of time, we have digitized our 100 years of publication from 1916 to 2016. We had done at that phase of point of time. And this was really released by the Honorable Minister during the centenary program. Other than the library repository, we have also digitized our old library collections, which was not for public use, but the digital archive, this is the faunaofindia.nic.in, that is available for everyone for public use, and it's free of cost. So in case if any of you need it, you can always go to Google and you can type it and you can find it out and access the publications. The other one is the ZSI, Zoological Survey of India, Faunal Information System. This is basically at present a type specimen repository. We also have ZSI collections.in, and these are type specimens repository, but what we want to do that it would be the broad spectrum information about the entire fauna of India in due course of time, when we are able to populate all the portals are populate with complete information which we have. But I don't know, it's going to take some time and it's an ongoing process. So that is also available. And in case you want to access, you can always go and find it out. The other one is a species page of species page, which is about the fauna of India, where you can basically access any of the species by name. It's a search option. It's a searchable database. You can type your species and you can get information on the species. This is, however, not available to general public yet. That is going to take some time. And then we have the other most important database which we have is a geospatial database. We have at present around 8.5 lakh records of the entire fauna of India on a geospatial scale. And this database is not available to public. And I guess we won't be making it available to public in the near future. It'll take some time. So in due course of time, we may be allowing some people restricted access to this database once the work is, a substantive amount of work has been done. So this is one screenshot about the database which we are preparing for the species. This will have the image as well as the information, as well as the literature, as well as the geospatial mapping of the particular species. And this is one of the most ambitious projects which has ever been taken up by ZSI. So one of our important aspects are the outreach activities which we do, which is about, as you can see, museums, this, that. We have aquariums, galleries, museums. And these are, we also impart a lot of training to the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau as well as the law enforcers, especially about the CRPF and the Border Security Force, as well as the Customs Department, because of the for aiding and abetting the wildlife crime control. So we are in collaboration. We have recently, if you must have heard, that we have recently collaborated with, we have signed an MOU with the Natural History Museum of UK, Natural History Museum London, and we would be working together in very close cooperation with them. And I guess we would be one of the platforms which you can use in future in case you need any help or any access to any of the specimens which is in the Natural History Museum London. You can utilize us as one of the platforms, or it can be one of the means of transport if you need to access it. So that would be one of the good things I think we can share in future. We are also a part of the Barcode of Life project. And we have submitted, and we do have a kind of MOU with them also, and we have been working in very close cooperation with them. These are some of the collaborations which we have with the different organizations. And there are quite a few of them now. Most of them are basically because of PhD programs and research activities. And some of them are because of sharing of information most of the time. So now coming to the concept of, what I was saying, taxonomy, back to the basics, as well as a functional group. So we know arthropoda are one of the priority groups in ZSI. We do have another priority groups are the vertebrates, that includes the mammals, the birds, the reptiles, and the insects, as well as the marine component. We do have a very strong marine group, as well as a very strong mollusca group, which is also a very strong group. But what I have seen from my joining of ZSI, that the arthropoda happens to be one of the pillars of ZSI, as we always very proudly say. So, there are crustaceans which are there. along with crustaceans. And see, this is one of the interesting things I wanted to say. We are working on this species, Schedule 1 species of Birgus latro, which is in Andaman, the coconut crab. And we have been working on the status of this species, and we have come out with some very fantastic information on this. And I guess it is going to be published very soon. So these are some of the arthropods which we are basically working on. Myriapods, which I guess you must be knowing. These are the arachnids, which we have a very strong team of arachnids. You know, we have spider experts, mite experts, as well as scorpion experts. All three of them are now available in ZSI. So in case if you need anything specifically in terms of biological control, is any of the work which you want to share with us, or you want to basically share information, or you work in collaboration, these may be one of the places where you can collaborate on. So if we come to the insects, so insects that happens to be the strongest mainstay of ZSI, and we are one of the only institutes in India who are working on Colembola. I guess there is nobody else other than that at present. There were some previously, but at present, I don't think there is anybody else working on Colembola. And termites is one of our mainstay. Odonates is one of our very strong points in ZSI. Hemipterans are also one of our major strong points. And Hymenopterans, obviously, that will be very strong because, with NBIR also and with our ZSI also, the Hemipterans would be one of the major issues which we are always working on. And we are working, we have a very strong team of Hymenoptera experts. And there are several new species which are described every year from this group. So especially on the chalcid wasps, which are of interest to the NBIR scientists also to a lot of extent. This is order Coleoptera, and Coleopterans, I guess, Dr. Devangshu Gupta has been collaborating, Dr. Kailash Chandra was an expert on this, and they have been working, and quite a few people from NBI were also working on Coleoptera, which I had the chance to meet when we had that conference last time. So Lepidopterans, this is one of our primary areas, thrust areas, which we are working on, not only because, as well as the flies, which I myself work on. So this is also one of the major groups which we are working on. So I'll just skip through this because this is not something I guess we would be discussing on. The current status of the insect orders and the insect orders is, this is what has been presented. And this is basically the diversity of insects, which were, and it's a comparative of the insects between the world and India, and where you can see that a lot needs to be done. If you consider India, there is still a lot which can be done in the insect taxonomy as well as in the insect diversity studies. And that basically keeps us organizations like us very relevant, because there is so little which has been discovered, even vis-a-vis the world record, let alone the, you know, the basic, the complete information. So vis-a-vis the world record, there is much needed to be done. And I guess that is what makes us and will keep us relevant for years to come. So these are the, we have something around 27 insect groups which are being worked upon in ZSI at this point of time. And some of them have several experts and some of them have very few experts. And in case we advertise a lot of times for research scholars, and if there is somebody whom you know or some of you who are listening to this and you're working on some of the rare groups, please feel free when we advertise to come and be in touch with us, because we are also in lookout for people who are working on the lesser known taxa. You know, all of the insects are not exactly that as the 4, 5, 6 major groups which I've discussed, of which the Hymenopterans are the most worked upon. Then it is the Lepidopterans. Then it is the Hemipterans. And even of the 4 major groups, the Dipterans are very little worked upon. I hardly find any experts in Diptera. There's only a few people who, very small group of people who are working there. So other than that, there are so many other groups. There are a total of 27 groups which people are working, which is available, but for which we don't have any experts. So because this is a big platform, and I guess there are 68 to 70 people who are attending this program. So in case any of you are working on these lesser known groups, feel free to contact us, because we are interested in taking up the lesser known taxa. We are interested to harness the expertise on these lesser known taxa so that we can also improve upon the present status of the fauna, the insect diversity of our country. So please feel free and contact us if needed. Okay, so this is some of the case studies which I would like to share with you because of the kind of work which we are doing now. It is not only about, because as I said when I started off, like whenever we are presenting ZSI, the first thing which comes, which people say is that, aap log list banate. So it's not about making a list. So I guess there are a lot of people who are sitting there, and I'm happy to be a part of a program where everybody shares my sense of belonging to the subject and my sense of feeling of importance of being a part of the subject is that it's a lot more than making an inventory. So suppose we take the Coleoptera, which we are working on in ZSI at present. The stage one would be always assessing the number of the diversity of the fauna. We work, as I said before, for each and every group of insects, or maybe non-insect category also, we have the data for each and every of this insect Coleoptera from the different biogeographic zones of India. We have a complete data set for that. So eight have been published, but 10 not published, but we have a complete data set. We also have the complete data set of Coleoptera, status of the Coleopterans in the different states and union territories. As you can see, for each of the states, the number of Coleopterans have been here. It has been marked out for each of the state. What is the current status of the number of species known from each of the states and union territories of India? So other than the states and the union territories, the third component is the ecosystem diversity. So for ecosystem diversity, we have information regarding this specific insect group over all the ecosystems. Like most of the important ecosystems have been covered. A few of them are in the pipeline, as I've said before, and you're going to get the information in due course of time. So new discoveries is one of our mainstay, and these are the new discoveries which have come up in the recent years in the Coleopterans. So this is our status of the number of new species between 2011 and 2020, 28 new species of Coleopterans and beetles have been described in India from ZSI. So the second group of priority, would I say, is Lepidoptera. So here, one is, as I said, primarily our primary job is documenting the Lepidoptera diversity. As I've seen shown before for the beetles also, it's the same with the Lepidoptera. That is our primary job. So then there is the species documentation. So here now at present, if you see this chart, you can understand that how we have basically spread ourselves over the period of years. We are not only working on taxonomy, we are using taxonomy as a basic stepping stone for doing the rest of these, doing the rest of the research, which you can see around. First one is the new discovery of the new taxa. Second is documentation of the species. The third is biodiversity assessment. Fourth is the barcode database of the Indian Lepidoptera that is being developed. The fifth is solving the taxonomic quagmire for the cryptic species, for species having very closely morphologically aligned for them. Then there is also the species distribution, mapping and modeling of the species. So this is one of the, a presentation of the kind of work which we are doing at present with the different insect groups. So other than this, you can see that we are also working on the scanning electron microscopic structures in order to assess the different or characteristics of the lepidopterans also, and how they can be distinguished between using these ultramicroscopic structures for species distinction. This one of the major important activities of ZSI at present, especially the Lepidoptera section, is assessing the Lepidoptera is a long-term monitoring in the Indian Himalayas. We have kind of framed up long-term monitoring plots where we are assessing the Lepidoptera assemblages, and that we have reported altitudinal shifts for more than 15 species of Lepidoptera. This is not only for Lepidoptera. This is also applicable for a lot of pollinators also. And these insects are working as potential indicators of climate change and the habitat health of the Indian Himalayas. So this is one of the extension works which we are doing at present, which is part, would I say, the applied aspect of our research. As I said before, that we are trying to make the research more relevant in respect of climate change, more relevant to the habitat loss, to the biodiversity loss, to climate change, and how the species are changing in their patterns. That is what we are trying to assess at this point of time. So here, as I said before, we are one of the mainstays of our work. As I said, as we are gradually, expanding our horizons, as I would say, we are not shifting, we are basically expanding our horizons through different applied aspects of work other than the traditional taxonomy and research. As I said, back to basics, we start from the basics and then how do we move forward or how we spread ourselves. So we are now working on pollinator research and our hymenopteran groups. The major four groups which are working on pollinators are the hymenopterans, the dipterans, the lepidopterans, the coleopterans, and the hemipterans. So there are several projects in which we are now working, which are funded by the National Mission for Himalayan Studies, and whereas there are several projects funded by the Department of Science and Technology, which are allowing us to work on the pollinators of the Himalayas as well as the different parts of the countries and different ecosystems. And we have several PhD students who are working on insect pollinators at present. So these are some of the teams which has come down to ZSI for during that pollination. There is a collaborative project with the International Pollinator Initiative and the National Pollinator Initiative. And these are the people who had come down to have a look at one of our pollinator collections. So these are some of the glimpses of it. So the third priority areas are our hemipteran bugs. So here, as you know, that they are major pests. And several of our hemipteran experts have been in contact with the NBIR scientists on several of the occasions. And basically, the person who is working on this group, she has also from this slide where how ZSI, NBIR can work together in the different aspects of pest management, and how they can basically convert and also help the farmers on the ground. This, I think, is a very interesting slide. But I mean, she has packed in so much of information that it's going to take me an hour to complete it. So, this is a kind of a nutshell in where we can see that where ZSI and NBIR can work together, as well as reach out to both researchers and scientists in the lab on my right, as well as to the farmers and the ground level workers on my left. So the other important group, which priority groups, is Hysonoptera or the thrips. So here we are in thrips. We are basically working on four components. One is the taxonomic studies, the DNA barcoding, comparative mitochondrial genomics, as well as working on the gut microbiome. So the thrips have one of the most basically extensive work which we are doing now. In fact, we have one of the most strongest team on Hysonoptera studies now in ZSI at present. I guess nobody in India is as strong as our team in ZSI. And there are at least 16 new species which has been described. 30 new records have been described from India. There have been different reports on pest and vector or species of thrips. And there is also a first report of the pest thrips from India. So DNA barcoding, basically the person, Dr. Vikas Kumar, who is a DNA CG, the officer in charge of the DNA barcoding laboratory, he is also the thrips expert. So we have the largest DNA barcode library with 1,326 barcodes for 210 species of thrips, which I guess is the largest in India. Or maybe it's the largest in world. It definitely is the largest in India, but it's also the largest in the world. So this may be a point of interaction with NBIR because they are also working on agriculturally important pests. I guess you are in touch with him also. So these are some of the aspects of the Thysanoptera which they were working on. It's about the this is a phylogeny of the thrips. And there is recently we have also started working on the comparative mitochondrial genomics of Thysanoptera. And this has basically given some very interesting results. And we are planning to take this mitochondrial genomics for the other groups also, which may be very important in the near future. So this is one of those complicated things you can see, which I won't go into the details. Okay, the third, the next one is, okay, there is some microphone, which I guess is on. So the other one which is working on is a gut microbe of Thysanoptera using next-gen sequencing. And basically we have found that the genus Arsenophonus, which is a male killing bacteria, which dominates the bacteria of the gut of the thrips. And it is this high abundance of the genus which promotes the thylotoxic behavior in the thrips. G usually along with the predicted results in killing of the males. And this is one of interesting finding which we have found this gut microbiome study in the Thysanoptera. So other pests, the other part is the parasitoids. We are also working on the plant parasitoids. And these are one of the Hymenopteran team is very is one of the strongest parasitoidic experts. In fact, we have the largest group of parasitoid experts in ZSI at present. And they have been working on several aspects, especially on parasitoids of Northeast India. And one of our primary activities is to find them the importance of their role in integrated pest management, as well as in biological control. And also we are preparing the GIS maps for major parasitoids, which may be helping and which will be useful in the near future for all the agricultural scientists, as well as those who are involved in the agricultural practices about how the parasitoids are distributed and how they can be useful or maybe involved in this whole practice in the near future. So these are the different groups for which we have expertise available in ZSA. As you can see, it's quite a few of them. There are almost 30 taxonomic experts working on the parasitoids. So Diptera section is one of my sections, so I won't go into the details of what kind of research we are going. So we are doing one of the new things which we have now working on in the Diptera section is the Center for the Disease Vectors, where we are doing faunal inventorization of the mosquito vectors. We are doing ecological modeling for proactive management studies and studying population dynamics. There is an advanced real-time surveillance system which we are doing. We are also developing a Wolbachia, indigenous Wolbachia database. And there is an eco-friendly management of mosquitoes. So there are quite a few objectives which we are working on at present. And we have got some fantastic results. Inventorization, this is always a cup of tea. So not much would, I don't want to go back and elaborate on that. This ecological modeling is also something which we have been working on. And we have got some, we have basically able to develop models to predict peaks of population and durations in advance, based on survival, reproductive potentials, life tables, and developmental periods. So this thing has been extremely important because this is a kind of a predictive modeling to see how the reproductive potentials and the life tables and how the species are going to survive or they can be basically controlled. So one of the major mosquito control system. We have also been able to establish advanced real-time surveillance system as opposed to the classical surveillance system, which is basically cheap and it's much more efficient. And we have already we had applied for a patent, and the paper which is supposed to be, I mean, several part of it is cleared and is going to be come out in 2021. So there is a Wolbachia database, which is an indigenous Wolbachia database for different species, which is also a point which we are working on in mosquitoes. Now, this is one product which we have actually formulated, which is a larvicidal formulation from essential oils. This has been prepared by Dr. D.S. Suman in collaboration with some other laboratories. And this, the patent has been, we have already patented the product, and this product has also been released in the market. We are now waiting for the reports to come back from the efficacy of the products, which I guess, as of now, the laboratory reports have been very, have been very efficient. So the efficacy is pretty high as far as I can go think of. Now you're working for the, basically the block level, people to come back with their results about regarding the efficacy of the product, which I'm very positive that we are going to get some very positive results on that. So another aspect of work which we are doing in Diptera is the new is on the nutrient recycling flies. So here we have found that that there is a that density of the bacteria, gut bacterial assessment, and we have found that we could isolate a potent protease enzyme from the gut symbionts of the nutrient recycling flies. And these bacteria may be, these bacteria produces sufficient amount of protease enzymes, which can be biotechnologically upscaled. So these are one of those interesting researches which I have done. And we have found that, I just skipped through the slides because the utility of the study is that this particular bacteria can produce sufficient amount of gut enzymes, which can be biotechnologically upscaled and can be used in the biotechnology industry for production of, biological production of the protease enzymes, which can be basically by simply cultivating these flies, which are so very easy to breed basically. So it'll be much more cost efficient in the long run. And if we be able to use it or maybe implement it in the long run, we'll be having some fantastic results. So I'm basically coming to the end of it. So one of the latest which we are working on is climate modeling and analyzing the species distribution patterns in insects. For one, which is mapping the spatial pollination supply and oval approach for managing, you know, pollinators and ecosystem services are something which is very big now in the CBD as well as in the CBD. So we have been trying to work on this. So, and in how this pollinators and the pollination supply of pollinators and the pollination, process can help in managing ecosystem services. So these are some of those in which we have already started working. This is a case study in Portugal from where we are drawing references so that we can work, especially in the Himalayan regions. The other one is also that we are trying to map the zoonotic disease emergence risk post-COVID. And this has actually is one of the interesting things which the Forest Department wants us to look into it for the protected areas. They are basically after our throats to work on something, which is basically the zoonotic diseases and the insects. And we have actually projected something to the Forest Department, and we are waiting for the funding. And I guess we would be getting some fantastic, if we get some funding, we will be working on something in the near future on this. So this is some of this. And the third one is the iDNA initiative, which is possibly we have not yet started, but we are planning in the long run that this invertebrate-derived DNA from hematophagous insects may be used for not only analyzing the wildlife, not only understanding the way of spread of infections, but this iDNA derived data can be combined with the state-of-art analytical tools for estimating wildlife abundances, population dynamics, and distribution. This is also something which we are planning to work on in the recent future, I would say. So some of the patents and products which we have basically in the last few years, we have patented and we have produced. One is this herbal mosquitoes. Then the other one is this advanced traps for mosquito surveillance, for which the patent has been patent application has been filed. The second is automated surveillance system, with which the patent has already been published. And future is we want to get a database is always a cup of tea. And this is one of the eco-friendly, this is another of the patents, but this is not related to the insects. This is one of the patents which has gone for filing. And I guess it's going to be, it will be released very soon, it will be published very soon. So we will be having, I won't go into the details of it. And I guess more or less, I have kind of elaborated on what ZSI does, what we are doing at present, and how we would be basically, we can in future be working together. And thank you so very much for listening to it so patiently. I guess it's almost 1 hour, I guess slightly more than an hour. And thank you so much about it.
Thank you, madam.